to start our new module, and this new module will be devoted to boundary layers and wakes, very important fluid mechanical patterns, fluid mechanical types that play crucial role in performance of actually any engineering systems where fluid motion, both gas or liquid, involved. Module includes 5 lectures. We start with some key definitions, and by the end, you will have sufficient knowledge and skills to make simple predictions and solve some problems. Let's start with defining boundary layer. We consider a very simple case of uniform homogeneous flow. Homogeneous uniform flow means that velocities, defined with symbol U capital with subscript M, don't change direction and magnitude across the flow. So it's a uniform flow, simple flow. Real life situation gives us a variety of cases, but theoretically, it would be sufficient to start with this case. And let us ask questions or question. What is going to change in this velocity distribution if we insert a flat plate, solid plate, in this uniform flow? It's interesting that although this question seems like complicated, the answer can go straight away if we recall two features for fluid motion that we learned from two previous years. These features is first, no discontinuity in velocity field, which means that if we introduce any disturbance in the fluid, flowing fluid, there will be no sharp changes in the fluid. Everything change in velocities will be smooth. And second, no slip condition. No slip condition means that velocity of fluid particles on the surface, solid surface, will be equal to zero. They will be stick to the surface. So this condition is known as a no-slip condition. Now, we can use these two features and predict that no-slip condition means that velocity of fluid particle velocity at the surface will be equal to zero, and no discontinuity means that everything will go very smoothly. Just using these two conditions, we can predict that velocity in the flow will be modified near solid surface, like with this red line. Velocity starts with zero, and then will be sharply increasing, but smoothly increasing until it reaches external flow. This allows to subdivide the flow region into two subregions. External flow away from the boundary, and this external flow doesn't know about existence of this solid plate. And very close to the boundary, sometimes it's a very thin layer, where velocity changes smoothly from zero to the level of external velocity. And this region, thin region, is termed boundary layer. Boundary layer appears to be a fundamental concept in fluid mechanics, both theoretical and applied. This concept has been introduced by great engineer and scientist Ludwig Prandtl, a German scientist, fluid mechanicist, hugely contributed to foundations of modern fluid mechanics. Being a young man in just 29 years old, he introduced this concept and some equations behind this physical concept. Before boundary layer concept has been proposed, engineers had very little understanding about friction. Why we need to spend energy to move things, and we need to spend this energy, appears, just to overcome friction at the solid boundary. And this friction at the solid boundary due to existence of the flow boundary layer. Let's, after this very, very qualitative description of boundary layer, look at how boundary layer develops along the plate if it's inserted again in this type of the flow, uniform flow. In our considerations, we will use a coordinate system that starts at the upstream end of the plate that engineers call leading edge of the plate. It will be zero, orthogonal coordinate Z, and streamwise coordinate X. If we insert such a plate in the flow, we'll have development of the flow as shown here on this sketch. At the very beginning, due to no slip conditions, we'll have emergence of the boundary layer, and it's grow along the plate. Initially, it will be lamina. Why lamina? Because thickness of the layer will be very small, and therefore Reynolds number will be very small. Flow will be stable, and therefore lamina. But along the plate, the thickness will be growing. And at some point, this thickness would reach the value that would secure sufficiently high Reynolds number to start transition from laminar flow to turbulent flow. After this relatively short distance of transition, we have emergence of turbulent boundary layer, where nearly the whole thickness of the boundary layer will be turbulent. It's interesting and important to note that with beginning of transition, the thickness of the laminar part of the boundary layer sharply reduces, as shown here, and never disappears. Even in the very high Reynolds number part of the boundary layer, where 99% of the thickness of the boundary layer covered by turbulent flow, you'll have very thin region adjacent to the boundary where it's laminar. And why? Because, again, no slip condition. We have very low velocity at the boundary, and therefore flow is stable and laminar. This simple pattern emerges from numerous experiments with visualization and use of sophisticated instrumentation in wind and water tunnels. These experiments suggest that the boundary layer along the plate can be subdivided into two regions, key regions, laminar and turbulent, with very short transition between these two. Transition occurs at Reynolds number, 500,000, and this Reynolds number is built with variables a little bit unusual for you, but essentially it has very clear physical explanation. Velocity of external flow, UM. As a characteristic length, we use here X, distance from the leading edge, and nu is a kinematic viscosity of the fluid. Distance from the leading edge, X, here serves as a measure of the characteristic length, because typically we would use thickness of the boundary layer, but with the moving downstream from the leading edge, this thickness increases, somewhat dependent on the distance from the leading edge, X. Therefore, this Reynolds number is used. I would like again to underline that within the fully turbulent part of the boundary layer, we have still two regions. Turbulent region, it's major part of the boundary layer, and very thin region that engineers call viscous sublayer, where viscosity dominates and flow nearly laminar. In real life applications, it's a 1 millimeter, even less than millimeter. It looks like very small, and one could neglect it, but physically we cannot neglect this. It plays crucial role in the dynamics, this very thin layer. That means that even small things sometimes can have major influence. This picture, as I mentioned, emerges from experiments, and here I would like to show you an example from a wind tunnel visualization that shows that laminar, very smooth part, undergone some transition and then become fully turbulent downstream. To deal with boundary layers, of course, we need to use some quantitative measures to describe boundary layer. One of such measures can be velocity profile within the boundary layer. And another obvious measure would be thickness of the boundary layer. Thickness of the boundary layer, which would provide some measure of the extent of the layer within which velocity changes from zero to the external flow velocity. Engineers use three types of thicknesses: disturbance thickness, displacement thickness, and momentum thickness. Disturbance thickness is simplest from these measures, and it gives geometrical measure of the boundary layer. Ideally, it would be good to define this thickness at the point where velocity reaches the external flow velocity. Engineers, however, use slightly different measure. They use distance at which velocity within the boundary layer reaches 99% of the external velocity. Thus, this geometrical measure is defined as shown here on this equation, just distance from the wall or the surface of the solid plate where velocity reaches 99% of the external flow velocity. Any ideas why engineers don't use just position where boundary layer velocity reaches external velocity? Why it's used 99%? The explanation is simple, because this transition is asymptotic. That means it changes very, very, very slowly towards that external velocity. And in principle, from measurements, it's very difficult to obtain, essentially impossible. So engineers agreed to have 99%. They could agree 98 or 97, but it happened that 99% appeared to be accepted. So first measure is disturbance, it's geometrical measure. Second measure, so-called displacement thickness. It's a mass conservation measure that reflects effect of the solid plane of on mass transport around the plane. It can be defined as a thickness of undisturbed flow that provides the same volume flow rate as that lost within the boundary layer due to friction. What it's essentially means that engineers use the thickness that would have the flow of with undisturbed velocity that would be equal to the lost flow rate due to effect of friction. To define this thickness mathematically, we use two notions. Frictionless flow rate, it means that what flow rate would be close to the boundary if boundary layer would not exist. That means there would be external flow velocity multiplied on delta z, thickness of some elementary region with vertical size delta z. Real flow rate would be real velocity multiplied on delta z. We can define difference between two values to obtain flow rate deficit. It's a lost flow rate within this region with thickness delta z. Now we can sum up all these subregions within the boundary layer, which mathematically can be done using vertical integration from the surface to the disturbance thickness, which is a geometrical measure. So we'll obtain this lost mass transport. According to definition, this lost mass transport can be equated to the transport of the same magnitude, but in the undisturbed flow. That means that this flow rate undisturbed will be product of the external velocity on that thickness that we need to define. And we define this using just dividing both parts of this equation on the external flow velocity. What essentially this thickness means that if this value for the same geometrical thickness, this value is very high, this means that friction is higher. So it's a measure of friction. Geometrical property gives measure of the extent of the boundary layer, and displacement thickness gives measure of the friction, how much friction contributes to the slowing the flow close to the boundary. And third type of the measure of the thickness of the boundary layer, momentum thickness. Momentum thickness is defined exactly in the same way as a displacement thickness, but this way we consider lost momentum flux, not lost flux of mass, but momentum. And similar to the previous definition, we will consider two notions. Frictionless momentum flux within the boundary layer and real momentum flux within the boundary layer. Momentum flux essentially is a rate of transport of momentum with some transport velocity. Um is a transport velocity, and here small u, real u, and this is external flow. And in brackets, it's actually momentum. If we discard small velocity symbol here and here, we will turn back to the definition of the displacement rate. So conceptually, it's exactly the same. And we can define the deficit of momentum flux by subtracting one value from another. Similarly to the previous case, we can obtain the lost momentum flux within the boundary layer just by integrating this difference from zero to the upper edge of the boundary layer. Following definition, we can equate this integral to the product of the momentum in undisturbed flow, if flow would be undisturbed close to the solid plate, on the transport velocity, which would be undisturbed velocity. And from this equation, we can now resolve our expression for theta, which is momentum thickness. Momentum thickness represents, again, another feature of the boundary layer. How boundary layer efficient to suppress momentum flux. So we have now three measures of the boundary layer. Geometrical thickness, it's a spatial extent. We have displacement thickness that shows efficiency of the boundary layer to reduce mass transport within the boundary layer. And third measure is a measure that characterizes the capability of the boundary flow to reduce momentum flux. So these three measures represent different aspects of the boundary layer, different facets of the boundary layer. With these definitions, which are extremely important, and you will see it in our consideration today at the end of lecture, These three measures are used on a daily basis by engineers who deal with engineering systems where fluids are involved. Next point today is to derive so-called momentum integral equation. This momentum integral equation is a simple equation that nevertheless is critically important for the whole concept of the boundary layer. We'll discuss the simplest form of this equation, but more complicated forms can be derived following the same procedures. Today, instead of differential equations, we use control volume approach, where we build all our consideration around the control volume. Control volume is a volume with some imaginary boundaries, and we can, using conservation laws, to do some accountancy, essentially, for forces, for momentum, and then derive equation without involving much differential equations, such as Navier-Stokes equations. This green line shows the shape of the control volume, but this shape depends on your intuition, for example. Specific shape of the control volume for our consideration shown here. Before I comment on this control volume, I would like to mention that we consider in this lecture steady flow. Steady flow means that no change in time in flow properties. Two-dimensional, that means that no change in flow properties across the flow. That means that orthogonal to this plot, no changes. And therefore, we don't need to consider anything what depends on the transverse coordinate. And so-called zero pressure gradient boundary layer. Zero pressure gradient boundary layer means that pressure gradient along the flow is equal to zero, no change of pressure in external flow. And that means that no change in velocity in the external flow. Now, we choose to have a control volume that is bounded by the plate itself. It's a lower border of the control volume. Two vertical planes, AC, ED, separated by small distance, delta X. And streamline that crosses the point where vertical plane ED and upper edge of the boundary layer crosses. We just choose it. Control volume can be any. But of course, we need to build this control volume in a way that would be beneficial for us. And we have benefit of this. Upper boundary streamline. I just would like to remind you that streamline is an imaginary line connecting points in space at a given instant, as velocity at any point will be tangential to this line. And what it means that there is velocity orthogonal to this line would be equal to zero. So no mass or momentum exchange between this part of the flow and this part of the flow, because it's streamlined. This is the reason why we chose an upper boundary as a streamline. Now, what is it momentum equation? And we consider momentum equation in streamwise direction, most relevant for defining friction. Momentum equation, or integral momentum equation, is a form of the second Newton law. Second Newton law states that force acting on the body is equal to rate of change of momentum of that body. Therefore, to derive appropriate form of this equation for engineering applications, we can equate all forces acting on the control volume to the change of momentum within the control volume and change between input of momentum into the control volume and output. Now, due to these conditions specified at the top, one of these terms should disappear. We don't need to consider it. What term is it? This is general equation. But considering our special case, we can, please, first one. Very good. So things become easier because we have steady state case. And it's a very typical case in many applications. There are, of course, more complex cases, but such consideration is sufficient for approach many things in our designs. Let's start to defining all forces acting on the control volume and then difference in momentum influx and outflux from the control volume. On side AB, we have force created by pressure. And this force, pressure force, would be pressure multiplied on the area AC. Again, keep in mind that we use just height, and I call it area simply because we consider this per unit width across the flow. We don't need to have any additional terms unnecessarily. And from opposite side, ED, we'll have pressure multiplied on the size ED. Pressure will be the same because we have zero pressure boundary layer. Pressure doesn't change. We have one more component from the pressure. Component created by the projection of line CD on the plane ED. So we have this small projection where still pressure in streamwise direction acts, and this pressure contribution would be product pressure on the projection size, which is different, ED minus AC. And finally, one more force that we need to consider is friction force at the surface, tau zero. That is a stress, frictional stress between flow and water and solid boundary, which we defined with tau zero symbol. Putting things together, we can say the total force acting on the control volume in streamwise direction can be defined by combining all these contributions. Or finally, total force appear to be for zero pressure gradient boundary layer equal to tau zero shear stress multiplied on delta x. Now we can move to the next part. We need to define momentum fluxes. The momentum flux through AB can be defined with this integral. And I would like very briefly explain why we use this integral. It can be presented as a sum of contributions within narrow subregions with the height delta z, and this number is n, number of these subregions. So I just rewrite this integral in a simplified form like this, where we have rho u is momentum per unit volume, and flux means that we need to multiply this substance momentum on the transport velocity so that we can have momentum flux or rate of transport of flux with velocity u. Similarly, we can define the flux of momentum into the control volume between B and C, where we have external flow because it's above boundary layer. So we just use squared external velocity multiplied on the length BC. To define flux through ED, what we can do, we can take flux that goes into the control volume and add change of flux along the x direction within the delta x. This change can be described with this equation that shows rate, this d dx with brackets is a rate of change of momentum per unit length multiplied on delta x. We can do it because delta x is very small, and therefore this derivative can be considered as a linear within the small delta x. And therefore, we just multiply this derivative on delta x to obtain the difference. And now we can define out flux through ED, where we take flux that entered plus flux of momentum change along the control volume. And of course, we have nothing coming in or out through the streamline because, as I mentioned, velocity across this line is equal to zero. So no mass or momentum or anything transferred through this line. It's like impenetrable line. Let's put them together. So through ED, we have flux of momentum out of control volume defined with this equation. And we have two contributions through boundary layer and this upper part BC that gives us a contribution within the external part of the flow. Doing algebra, we can simplify this equation to this form that includes two terms. One term is completely defined by flow properties, boundary layer velocity. And external velocity is involved with the term where we have BC, which is something BC. It's not something that we can measure. It's it comes from our control volume, this thing. So we need to express BC with some measurable things to find this term. Another conservation law. Until now, we were dealing with conservation law for momentum. Another conservation law is mass conservation. Using this additional conservation of mass condition, we can obtain BC through flow properties. The condition of mass conservation means that efflux of mass through AB would be just integral of velocity over this AB distance, plus influx through BC. This is mass that every second enters the control volume. And this must be equal, following conservation law, mass conservation law, should be equal to the mass that leaves the control volume so that we keep the balance. And difference between them is equal to zero. Mass that leaves through ED can be defined in a similar way as we just discussed for momentum flux. We can make algebra from this equation and express this term using now external velocity and the integral of the boundary layer velocity. We now have expression for forces, we have expression for momentum fluxes, and we can put all these relationships into equation, second Newton equation, that tells that force is equal change of momentum. Force is tau zero on dx, delta x, and change of momentum, if we combine all terms, would be shown as here. External velocity is constant. It doesn't change along the flow. Therefore, we can move external velocity here in the brackets and under integral, because it's a constant value. It doesn't change across the flow or along the flow. This equation now contains on the right hand two derivatives, identical, means stream-wise derivatives. And therefore, we can move these brackets inside of these brackets and use just one derivative. It's just because they are commutative. And the result of this would be this equation. If you multiply both and divide this integral with a squared external velocity, we can further simplify this equation and present this as a product of the squared external velocity on the stream-wise derivative of the momentum thickness that we introduced at the beginning. At this point, I would like to highlight a very, very important point here, that this so-called momentum integral equation, it was first derived by a very influential engineer of last century, Theodor Karman, who introduced a lot of different things in engineering. And he is considered the father of defense industry, defense science in U.S. He moved to U.S. in the 30s when in Germany Nazi came to power, and he developed outstanding career in engineering and science there, created theory of turbulence, designed aircraft, designed navy, boat ships, a lot of things, very fundamental person. So he derived this, he was PhD student of Prandtl that introduced boundary layer concept. Why it's important? Because what is it tau zero? It's actually force at the border. It's a force acting at the surface. When we have a car moving on the road, we have boundary layer at the surface, on the roof, for example. And that boundary layer, mechanisms involved in creation of this boundary layer due to friction. So we have friction. If we can make some fancy roof, we can reduce this friction. But of course, there are other contributions to friction also, associated now with pressure drag, so-called. We'll talk about this. Or wakes, that's another part of this module. Now, what this equation means, even if you don't look into this, it means that force at the surface is defined by external velocity and distribution of the velocity within the boundary layer and the spatial extent of the boundary layer, delta. So it's very explicitly, this is the beauty of this equation, explicitly shows that force acting on the surface or on the body is defined by the thickness of the boundary layer that develops on this body, external flow, for example, higher speed of your car, the faster you drive, the higher friction, because external velocity for drive, it will be speed of the car, will be higher, and velocity distribution. Also, slight algebra shows, in addition, that this force can be defined as a product of the squared external velocity and streamwise change or streamwise gradient of the momentum thickness. And that again highlights the effect of momentum or significance of momentum thickness as a measure of the momentum flux changes within the boundary layer. To summarize, we developed this equation for zero pressure gradient boundary layer. And zero pressure boundary layer gradient means that pressure gradient dp dx equal to zero, velocity gradient equal to zero, and it's reflection of the zero pressure gradient, and we have this very simple equation. Here, just to remind you, expression of momentum thickness that we derived at the beginning of lecture. And if we consider general case when pressure can change along the plate, then in addition to the term that is involved in the zero pressure gradient boundary layer, we have additional term that now involves displacement thickness, so additional feature of the boundary layer, and change of external flow velocity along the flow. So you can, for example, drive your car through terrain where you have wind growing or dying, and then you'll have change in external flow velocity. That needs to be taken into account when you compute drag on your body.